Einen schönen guten Abend und herzlich willkommen hier im Kino des Deutschen Filmmuseums zu unserer Lecture in Filmreihe, die auch 2017 sich wieder mit Ernst Lubitsch beschäftigt. Ich finde das ganz großartig. Von November bis Juli werden wir hier fast im Zwei-Wochen-Tag, kann man sagen, uns mit Ernst Lubitsch beschäftigen. Internationale Experten sind hier und heute der mit der weitesten Anreise. Ich sage schon mal schön, dass er da ist, Kevin Billy aus den USA. Ein Applaus schon mal an der Stelle. Genau, und tatsächlich ist das heute ein besonderes Ereignis auch für uns, denn vielleicht waren Sie vor 3 Jahren schon mal hier, da war es bei der Warhol Lecture über Andy Warhol, da gab es immer mal wieder diese Abende, wo wir auch eine Doppelprojektion gemacht haben, also wo Sie sich vielleicht daran erinnern, dass links ein Film läuft und rechts daneben ein anderer, die zusammenpassen und als Konzept dann auch eine vielleicht neue Kunstform sogar erschließen. Daran knüpft das heute so ein kleines bisschen an, denn wir werden hier bis hierher in dieser Hälfte die Austernprinzessin sehen, von 35 mm aus unserem eigenen Archiv, live begleitet übrigens von Uwe Oberg, Sie haben ihn vielleicht beim letzten Mal schon erlebt. Ich möchte ihn an dieser Stelle schon mal vorstellen, er ist ein ganz wunderbarer Jazzmusiker vor allen Dingen, hat in Wiesbaden das Jazzfestival auch gegründet, ist dort bis heute aktiv, hat den Hessischen Jazzpreis auch bekommen und begleitet bei uns häufig eben Stummfilme und ist auch ein wirklicher Lubitsch-Experte, war letztes Jahr auf Lubitsch-Spuren dann in Kairo und hat dessen Orientfilme begleitet. Also an dieser Stelle schon mal großen Applaus. Uwe Oberg, steh mal auf, dass man dich sieht. Genau. Er wird das nachher dann parallel live begleiten. Wir hatten heute Mittag schon eine sehr erfreuende Probe. Ich kann Ihnen schon mal versprechen, das wird wirklich ein Ereignis, was wir gleich haben. Und Jazz ist vielleicht sogar das Stichwort, weil das ist improvisiert. Ich glaube, die beiden wissen nicht so genau, was jeweils der andere macht. Und dann wird das so eine Art Jam-Session zu Lubitsch. Das ist ganz, ganz spannend. Ich sage noch ganz kurz, was wir als Rahmenprogramm, als Begleitprogramm in diesem Monat zu der Lecture-Reihe haben. Das ist im Januar auch wirklich interessant, denn wir zeigen Filme von Filmemachern, die ebenso wie Lubitsch aus Deutschland in die Staaten ausgewandert sind und die entweder mit ihm was zu tun haben oder die einen ähnlichen Werdegang vielleicht hatten, dass sie es eben unabhängig vom Zweiten Weltkrieg getan haben. Das ist zum einen jetzt als nächsten Mittwoch ein Film von William Dieterle, im Deutschen auch Wilhelm Dieterle, und zwar Der Glöckner von Notre Dame, The Hunchback of Notre Dame, sehr zu empfehlen, ein Film, den man wirklich selten zu sehen bekommt, und den absoluten Lubitsch-Bezug dann Ende des Monats, A Midsummer Night's Dream, ein Sommernachtstraum, und zwar von Max Reinhardt. Max Reinhardt war derjenige, der Lubitsch entdeckte. Der hat ihn mit 19 Jahren ans Deutsche Theater in Berlin als Schauspieler hinzugezogen und er war quasi einer der großen Lehrer von Lubitsch. Und das ist sein einziger Hollywood-Film und den haben wir dann vom BFI aus London, diese Kopie, kann ich Ihnen wirklich sehr ans Herz legen, ist ein spannender Bezug zu Lubitsch. Aber genug der Vorrede. Heute wird ein großartiger Abend, kann ich Ihnen schon mal versprechen. Und ich übergebe jetzt sehr gerne das Wort an einen unserer Kooperationspartner, nämlich die Goethe-Universität ist natürlich hier großer Partner, hat all diese Referenten ausgewählt und dem Cluster of Excellence, dem Exzellenzcluster Normative Ordnung, danken wir auch, dass es in diesem Jahr weiterhin kostenfrei möglich ist. Begrüßen Sie bitte Rembert Hüser. Herzlich willkommen und viel Spaß.
Hello, welcome everybody, thanks for coming. When Kevin Billy flew to Germany at the end of 2016, the following happened. First, during the flight, water spilled on his MacBook Pro, whom he had nicknamed Adorno in honor of our local hero of essay theory, and with whom he had produced around 300 video essays, among them his most famous work so far, Transformers, the pre-make. Adorno could actually be saved a week later with a special saline treatment in a self-designed lab in an obscure computer shop. He's with us at the Film Museum. Upon his arrival in Berlin, Kevin Billy started his term as the very first resident of the newly founded Harun Farocki Institute. Picking Kevin Billy as a scholar and artist to start this highly prestigious visual research residency not only sets the bar pretty high for future residencies, but it also programmatically aligns him as a pivotal figure of the international video essay scene with one of the most important essay filmmakers and artists, Harun Farocki. On January 7th, just 5 days ago, one of the leading German daily newspapers, the Süddeutsche Zeitung, which is not exactly known for writing extensively about film, published an article in its art section, Video Essayisten, das sind die Superstars der Filmkritik, singling out Kevin Billy as a shiny current example of this highly dynamic scene. On the same day, 200 videos of Gavin Billy and others were taken down from the Fender website. They were made for and for which Gavin Billy was still working as a leading video essayist when he embarked on his flight to Berlin. With Gavin Billy, developments always seem to come at a rapid pace. Over the past few years, we could witness the institutionalization and commercialization of the concept of the video essay, and it was Gavin Billy who was always the first at its various stages. While it usually never leads very far to ask for the very first to have done a particular practice, Gavin Billy is certainly among the pioneers and activists of the scene, starting his Shooting Down Pictures blog in 2007. He was the first video essayist whose work was invited to film festivals. He was the first whose work was shown at a retrospective as a film museum. Unfortunately, the Austrian Film Museum beat us to it. He's the first to receive broad scholarly attention himself. He's the first to have organized a commercial platform to collect and share video essays of colleagues. And with a residency, he's also one of the first to be officially acknowledged as a visual artist himself. How do all these firsts come to happen? I will try to offer an explanation. Yes, I think he's the best. He's analytic, he's critical, he's imaginative, he's witty, he's incredibly productive, and he's innovative. I'm even convinced that while Gavin Billy represents the genre video essay like no one else, the term itself might not be the most precise name for the radicality of what he himself is actually doing. Video essay seems to be a misnomer here. Having Gavin Billy opening lines of communication with Lubitsch, the Oyster Princess, tonight at the German Film Museum could not come at a better moment. If we take the most recent events together, then we can state three things, at least for the German context. One, the hype of the video essay is over, if even the Süddeutsche gets it. So the video essay is there. That's good news. New exciting candidates like the analytic, concise, GIF are knocking at the door. Two, with the broad acknowledgement of the video essay as a form, we now have time to get Adorno and those following after him working again, and we can give the still pretty emphatic idea of the video essay and the often highly utopian promises that it brings along with it, namely the video essay as a new universal remedy for research on film, a special cell line treatment in our self-designed labs. And we can then see what's left of it when we are done. How come so many examples of this hype genre that only is that one indiscriminately watches online are rather uncritical, not to say predictable and pretty boring? One caution with respect to transatlantic imports and reimports is in order here, though. While, from a German point of view, one might be wondering why, of all concepts, one would want to align one's own products with such a stiffy loaded concept like the essay, with its long history of pretense and longing for distinction. Farocchi, for example, referred to the essay in an interview as a useless term. One should know, however, that the term essay means something completely different in the US than in Germany. Three, Lubitsch's The Oyster Princess, the film that we are going to see tonight, was shot in times of inflation and deals with fantasies of nobility and capitalism in a historical context that has to reinvent rules. It is also an example of the failure of film criticism, canon formation, and the blind belief in authorities. This extraordinary film never quite got the overall respect it deserves. What the Fender scandal, which is just a tiny bump in the road for the history of the video essay, has brought up is a question of how to collect newly web-based works within the tension of commercialization and institutionalization. What are we aiming for? What are our parameters? Will it be an archive or will it be a museum with a hall of masters? Having Gavin Billy in the wake of these most recent developments, but without any pressure, develop his recipe for slurping Lubitsch's Oyster Princess before our very eyes is a special gift. What can we expect tonight? Mark and I can't tell, which is good. This is also a new format for us, an experiment that we look forward to because it matters to us what is at stake with the most demanding works of Gavin Billy. I would divide the video essay scene, and I apologize for this oversimplification of a rather differentiated scene, into three major strands. The first is a pretty conservative, cinephile celebration of the work of canonical authors. Lubitsch is Lubitsch because it is Lubitsch. I'm rather suspicious of this form, its big gestures, its mansplaining, and its desire for becoming art itself. The next two strands I like a lot, and they will be combined tonight. There's a video essay as a tool for training incoming film students at universities. This is great and has a long history, precursors to contemporary video essays were already taught at German universities via non-linear editing systems in the mid-90s. The third is what Kevin Beeley himself has called desktop criticism, which is the most precise term for what he is doing. And it sticks to the ethics of criticism for bringing the very conditions of its analysis, Adorno, to the foreground. Characteristic for this approach is the multiplicity of screens. Kevin Beeley was once invited as a respondent to what turned into a panel commemorating Harun Farocki's untimely death. He was still a student at the School of Art. School of Art Institute at Chicago back then, and responded to the creme de la creme of Farocki research, all of them amazing scholars, by first of all showing on Adorno the many usually hidden rituals of this event. Who was invited and why, according to Google, how the panel had already begun long before with Facebook posts, and showing us a restaurant where the panel had dinner the previous evening and where they were all seated at the table. I quote, "So here's the table. There were five of us. Some knew Farocki better than others did. Some did not know Farocki at all. And what was interesting was that in the conversation there were certain parties that would refer to him as Harun, and others that would refer to him as Farocki, including myself. I can literally map the Harun and the Farocki sections of the table. So we have a psychic map of relations between this person who was once alive and the politics of relating, where I was basically quiet for the entire conversation because the people who referred to Farocki as Harun had a lot to say." Quote. I will never forget this response. Desktop criticism of this type is exactly what we need these days, and fewer video essays that just dream of being on first-person basis with an auteur. The multiplicity of screens in a cinema attacks the rarely questioned convention of this place. That's why we will also screen The Oyster Princess for the purists on a single screen on Saturday. We should be aware, though, that throughout film history, the cinema has never solely been disciplined, quiet, church-like place of film exhibition in the dark that people today tend to assume it was and still is. The audiences of early cinema were, of course, very unruly. Japanese cinema knows the tradition of the banshees, the performers providing live narration next to the actual screening of the film, and film has more generally always been screened outside of cinema, today more than ever. Okay, Kevin Beeley wants to teach us now how to break up our cinema routines and get involved with The Oyster Princess. Welcome, Kevin, to the German Film Museum. What's cooking?
Thanks. Thanks, Lambert. Thanks, Uri. Good luck. All right, let's first give a hand for Uwe Oberg. If you don't like what I have to say, just hold this ear closed and listen to the music from there. All right, so. All right, that's it.
Thank you very much. Vielen Dank. Kevin Beeley, Uwe Oberg, Ernst Lubitsch. Begrüßen Sie Rembert Hüser jetzt hier vorne bei uns. Und ja, ich übergebe mit den Worten, das imponiert uns.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. This was really amazing. So we have... We can enter into the discussion right now. So we have many major players here: Kevin Beeley, Uwe Oberg, Ernst Lubitsch. So you can ask questions in German and in English, and also about your experiences with this kind of experiment: what worked, what didn't work, so what happened to the film and the process, and so all kinds of observations that you may have. So.
I would like to ask Kevin first, because it was the first time he did it this way. How did you like it?
I mean, it was definitely a very live experience. And, you know, I don't know what it looked like, but I felt like as it went on, it was almost like this constant negotiation between two screens. And I have to say, like, that screen really kind of prevailed. And and also not just that, but two experiences, this theatrical experience and then this strange, like, private experience that was happening with my friend in Romania, who's still chatting with me. And it was interesting. It's like, yeah, while I'm in the middle of that public kind of experience, I'm at the same time simultaneously retreating into this private experience, which is then being broadcast back to whoever wants to see it. So I'm still kind of processing all how all this fits together, but it happened, and it's still happening.
That was so cool. And Uwe, how was it for you? I would be interested for you. It was the first time too. Take the mic from Rembert.
I liked it. I liked the performance. So, and
was it like jazz?
In a way.
In a way.
Yeah. There was another actor on stage.
Yeah, I know. That's the
thing. It was different.
Well, there are multiple. I mean, there's the audience. What I didn't really think about was the role of the audience, because there's an energy coming from the audience that's then directing,
of course,
a lot of things. And I'll say, like, the fact that I cannot read German became actually this force that kind of pushed me more into my own experience of the film. So that made it more private for me, because I could not read German. And if I could read German, maybe the whole dynamic would be different. And then so
I felt like off Broadway. Really, this is a musical. You can do in Broadway; they will pay for that. And just because you on the chat, what is very nice to have somebody to talk about while making this, you said that doesn't make sense one with the feet. What could you tell me why?
Say
you
again.
Said that? You said that that's a scene of the feet. Wouldn't make sense or not in place. Not in place.
Yeah, because this is a living room. This is a living room experience in some ways. You know, when and Rembert forwarded me this really great article called "The Second Screen," right? And how there is this emerging trend for people, especially young people, to watch. When they watch a movie, they're not just watching the movie. They're watching their phone. They're watching internet. They're doing research. If they have a question about the film as they're watching it on TV, on the screen, on their laptop, or at home on TV, they'll just go and Google the answer. So that's really what I'm trying to enact here. And I mean, it's very perverse, and it feels, almost like a violation to bring that private second screen experience to a public setting. It felt very schizophrenic. and with this very, you know, the quintessential Cinematheque experience, which is the silent film with a live accompanist. Like, you cannot ask for a more kind of exclusive, only in theaters experience. And then to bring this into it, it's really like very schizophrenic. And me playing the role of, am I an expert moderating? Am I a searcher? Am I just another person in the audience doing private chat on his phone on Facebook? Like, I've got like three or four identities in my head as I'm trying to figure this out.
But believe me, if somebody can do it, it's you. Just one thing, because you have so much the association and research and things. The whole time I was watching, the father looks so much like the Grinch. Dr. Seuss, I said, I don't know if there is any, like, his people later actually use this figure in other films, something like that.
Thank you. Yes, hello. So my feeling was, for me and the audience, was some kind of relaxing the whole situation. Normally you doesn't talk here, but now I have the feeling, okay, I can talk with my neighbor.
Interesting.
So maybe, I don't know, is it for you, when you stand there?
I'm very tight, I'm very tense and nervous.
Okay. no relaxing.
Because it's like, what role am I playing? Who am I? What am I supposed to be doing? It's very schizophrenic. But I will say, your comment makes me realize, like, what this is creating more choice for the viewer. Like, you really... maybe you become more conscious that you're watching the movie instead of watching this, and you're making a value assessment. And, you know, if you think this is better than that, then you're right. I mean, because this is a masterpiece, and this is just a one-time you know, work in progress.
That's very interesting, because we in the film museum, we have a projectionist who says that's not allowed normally. You shall not talk, you shall not have anything else. It's very puristic what we normally want to have, and to educate the people in a way to feel or to be into the movie like we were before. And you broke that, and it was so interesting. So it's a very cool experience for us. Several questions from down to.
Hello, I found it very interesting what you did with the film, and thank you that I was allowed to watch it. And what I found very interesting was the chat with your friend. Yeah. And
anything you want to say to him? Yeah. Anyway.
And I wanted to ask how did you do it? Had you something like a bit like a script, talking about Bresson, talking about something else, or did you just do it without script and looking if it works or not?
Yeah, it was without script. It was just, the idea was just he was going to watch it the same time as we are, and he was watching it on YouTube at his home. And with an internet connection, just chatting with us. So, but he showed up late, and then I had to tell him where we were, so then we could be synced. So, yeah.
So it was more like a lucky experiment.
No, he knew it was going to happen.
Yeah.
Maybe I shouldn't have said that though.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks so much. This is really interesting to watch. Because I think a lot of us have seen the pre-make, and so it's quite different watching this live. But I was thinking about what you said in terms of it feeling schizophrenic, because quite often when we watch a movie at home, we do exactly what you did. We look things up, we look up characters, maybe we'll go on Wikipedia or Internet Movie Database or something, and that doesn't feel schizophrenic. I don't think somebody would describe themselves watching a movie on their laptop in their room and doing that at the same time as schizophrenic. And yet, was it something about being watched while you were doing it? Because quite often people say, okay, the best experience is the live experience because you're most attentive. And yet we know that quite often when we're in the live experience, we're not most attentive because we're looking at what other people are doing, we're thinking, are other people laughing, etc. So quite often when scholars write about things, they don't just go to the cinema to see the theater, but they get it on DVD, they go home, they look at it, because that's a better environment in which to look at something. But it doesn't mean that it's a singular screen at home. So what is it about this situation?
Yeah, I mean, this question of singularity, well, it has to do with context. I think when you're, I don't think this second screen experience at home is schizophrenic, because it's a self-directed flow within a context of I'm watching the film and educating myself about the film at the same time. And so it has this kind of linearity to it. It's like, I'll watch, oh, I have an idea about this film, or I have a question about it, I'm going to look here. But here I'm dealing with multiple questions at the same time, in terms of generating information, watching the film, generating information, being aware that there's another performer at the same time that I have some sort of relationship with, and the audience. So it's multiple contexts happening at the same time, and multiple roles, and multiple channels. Like, this is all happening at once, and I'm trying to find a linear path through it. But I feel more like a ping pong ball. And eventually what I did was realize that, wait, this movie is really great. I don't have to do so many interpretations or interruptions of it. And at some point, I want to be a viewer too. And so there was this nice kind of triumph of the film, because by the end, I would just prefer to watch it than to add many things to it. But I think I also resorted to the easiest kind of secondary activity, which is just chat with my friend, because that just was the most direct and simplest way of me to engage with the film at the same time. So this private experience in public became kind of an oasis.
Yes, hi. First of all, thank you. Earlier today, I watched your Transformers video, which I also thought was very great. And now we could watch you doing a video essay live, and therefore the question came to my mind: how do you usually work? Like, how long does it take you to produce a video essay? And how's your working process? Where do you get started? Like, do you cut down the film into scenes and acts, and then find whatever interests you and try to find like pictures, movies, comments on the internet, or how do you get started?
Yeah, it's all of that. And you know, it just kind of falls in an intuitive pathway of you watch, and I don't necessarily always watch a film from start to end. I'll watch until a question arises and then do some searching, do some research, or you know, I watch it in a timeline, and then if I start to become aware that, okay, this film has four acts, then okay, I'm just gonna go ahead and explore that structure. So it's really just being sensitive to questions that are naturally coming to mind as I'm watching, as I'm experiencing, and then pursuing those questions and seeing where they go. But it's, you know, that can use any number of techniques or approaches.
Yeah, thank you, Kevin. I had a comment and a question. I think when we were thinking, when Rembert and I were thinking of this project, one of the things that, at least one of the things that I didn't think about is what you were talking about, is that you, as a performer, are in competition, if you will, with Lubitsch, and Lubitsch is a showboater, as we say in English. Lubitsch, yeah. Really, and in that, a showboater, I mean in the sense that he demands our attention, but also rhythmically, it's very fast. And so he will win the audience very quickly, so that your choice to kind of retreat into the personal was perhaps something that a performer may do. But it was just, that was just a thought. But my question is just about, you a number of times you pointed out, you pointed out four acts, you pointed out two keyhole shots, and the number, and counting as a kind of analytical approach to cinema gets us some information, but as you pointed out in your critique of the Bresson hands, simply a kind of, you know, accumulation of of information isn't really of much analytic value.
Yeah, maybe we should watch that one just so we know what we're talking about.
So I guess I'm just interested in what you see as the strengths and weaknesses of counting for film analysis and for your audiovisual essay criticism.
Yeah, I mean, it's counting is a technique, but it's not an ideology. And if it is an ideology, then it's you know, it's an ideology of math. But you know, what is math? So it's just you know, it's a technique, but then what do you do with it? So yeah, this was the my friend who's still there. Gonna tell him.
Full screen now, by the way.
Full screen? Okay, after I chat. Oh, okay, thanks. So yeah, this, you know, this supercut, which is most popular video made about Bresson online. It's a compilation of all of his hands. And so, you know, you remember the scene where you see the hands passing the envelope back and forth in that one scene, and that stimulated my friend to bring this up. And so this question of what is this about? What is this type of analysis about? Okay, it's about hands of Bresson. Like, Bresson uses hands in a lot of his movies in this close-up way. And then what? So, you know, why? What's the historical or personal biographical significance of this, or dramatic significance? How are the hands used in different ways, in different contexts? That's not really discussed in this video, but it's really nice to watch, and so it has a lot of views, and it really gets you excited about Bresson. So, you know, I mean, but yeah, I guess I have a criticism of this video because it does feel very easy. It's very visually pleasing, but I'm not sure what questions it's asking. And to me, it's always the questions that are the most interesting. What are the most interesting questions you can be asking as you're watching a film? and that becomes a reflection and a critique of your own abilities and qualities as a viewer. What do you bring to the viewing experience? And so in some ways, this felt like a trial. This is like, this is the best I can do today. It's almost like an athletic event. Like, what's the best performance of knowledge I can coordinate around this film that I can bring tonight? So, you know, and I'm not a Lubitsch scholar. I wonder what a Lubitsch scholar would do in this situation, and how different that experience would be. I wonder if a different film, since, yeah, you mentioned it's Lubitsch, you mentioned it's a comedy, which has a very specific effect on an audience. If this was a drama film, if this was a Tarkovsky film, what would, you know, what would the audience reaction be to this presence? You know, it might be even more out of place. So, but we tried it.
Yeah, I was wondering if I'm right, you had the tendency, if you always, every time you compared the film with itself, with one scene, with different scenes or so, that you had the tendency to rather go forward. You would say, and this is a scene that is coming up a lot.
Yeah, right.
And I'm not sure, but there was not a moment where you said, this scene reminds me of the scene we have just seen or so.
Mm.
And I was wondering whether there is some reason for that or so.
Yeah, probably I'm playing catch up with the moment. So my experience of time is very different probably from yours, because you're watching this film moment by moment, whereas I'm performing I'm trying to bring value to the experience. Because I've watched the film, I've obviously did some planning and some anticipation, and in some ways by saying like, okay, now you're gonna come to this, it's my way of kind of staying one step ahead of you, so that I don't look like this like fool who doesn't know what he's just doing or saying. So there is a bit of a power dynamic at play, and the times where I fell behind, I almost wondered, If something I wanted to say had already passed the moment, I wondered, is it worth bringing it up? And I did that a couple times.
I was just thinking, because the film has such a quick path, it's so quick, it has such
yeah.
a speed. And whether it might be a way to kind of, to counter that, because you said you kind of felt lost a little, to counter that with turning back in the film, you know.
But sure.
I don't know. It's just.
But yeah, I wonder what effect that has on the viewer, in terms of trying to come out of this with a coherent cinematic experience, and then feeling these other currents, these other tides, if you want to use like water metaphors, like these other forces kind of pulling you in another direction. Yeah, it's visual and it's also temporal. Yeah.
I was wondering whether it makes a difference if you're sitting on the left or the right side, because I was sitting on the left, on the very left, and I, of course, saw a lot from your monitor, and the right side, I had to concentrate when I wanted to watch the movie, so because it's what's on the other side of the screen. I don't know how you experienced that on the right side, perhaps.
No, okay, can I add just another question to the audience? Because what interests me is what kind of effect the entire performance had, especially on those of you who are not familiar with the Oyster Princess before. As for me, I know this film fairly well. It was interesting what kind of effects. So I focused pretty much on Kevin's performance and on the music and saw some of the effects that resulted in this dissociation and in this fragmentarization of a film that usually always takes place. So when I watch a movie, I never watch a movie as a whole. I'm always bored in scenes. I think of other films and do so. So this is something that's always taking place. But I'm wondering what this kind of performance does to a film that one has not seen before, because I cannot quite imagine that. So I liked this jumping back and forth, but So how was it for people among you and who haven't seen this film before?
Luckily, I can answer that, because it was the first time I saw it. But I was really trying to say how well it worked because even though I hadn't seen it, I found it so interesting that you pointed out with showing the YouTube video of the formation of the girls, this contrast. It emphasized it very well, and still I got the storyline and everything. I would like to watch it again, like right, in itself. Peace, but I really enjoyed it, and I didn't feel like you were bothering the audience or something like that. Also, when you were more quiet or typing or even just watching yourself, I thought for a moment that it might also be planned as paying some respect to the art we're seeing, the music we're hearing, everything. So I actually thought it was rehearsed. And what I was trying to originally say is that as the audience, I had the urge to join you in your chat. I was actually...
Yeah, I was wondering if anyone was going to friend me on Facebook during this video and then start chatting with me.
It was really just like, you know, the live tweeting kind of thing. It would have been great if... we had like one scapegoat for that.
What scapegoat? What is that? Oh, this guy?
Or well, even one of us.
Who oh yeah, I mean that you're absolutely yeah. It was there was nothing stopping you from doing that for sure.
I have a small question because you admitted there had been some premeditation as to how you would synchronize or desynchronize the communication between the two regimes. And one of the greatest mismatches to me was Beyoncé. Yeah. It was painful.
Okay.
So
fair enough.
Please explain.
Why Beyoncé? Yeah, I mean, well, it's always for me a big question that persists for me is like, how do these films of the past live in the present? And you know, one answer is that they live in your mind. As they encounter your mind, they bring associations, and so this was the first association I had, just to see this sequence of amazing young female power and aggression being expressed in ways I don't think are very common in films of that time, and really with such force that it literally throws my mind into the present. Like it feels like a scene from 2017, and so my mind is thinking like, what are some images like that? I mean, I could have maybe played a sequence of it, so it wasn't so focused, but something about women, female power as a form, as an aesthetic form of bodies in coordination, in formation, expressing this type of power and this kind of identity. So it was a mashup, and and if you, I don't know if it's because you don't like the music, or you know, just the juxtaposition just seems kind of off or unsuccessful, but
yes, I would like to question or dispute that, and mm-hmm. I think that one can only arrive at that conclusion if you look at the film as you would as at a YouTube clip, for instance, because if you look at the film, you do see the poignant discrepancy or difference between how those bodies move in an unruly fashion and the bodies of Beyoncé's performance is very much more like the arrangement that you showed us with the servants.
Oh, that's a great
But that,
point.
That would have been a good example to match those.
Yeah,
two.
Because those bodies are definitely working in a sort of a commodity spectacle for MTV and the Beyoncé brand. And yeah, absolutely, absolutely. That's a good point. And yet, it is often used as a flag of like, you know, this is one of the greatest displays of feminism, like, you know, the past year, just Beyoncé's Lemonade performances. So, you know, you can make of that what you will.
I also hadn't seen the Oyster Princess before, and to give an answer to your question, I maybe it has something to do that I'm sitting a bit of more in the middle, and so I looked to Lubitsch's film, but also very much to your show, because when I saw you talking to your friend, it was sometimes like a bit like a help to understand things Lubitsch did in his film, because it's not always so easy to understand a silent film or a film by Lubitsch. And so you sometimes you were explaining something in your talk, in your chat, or sometimes you talked about things that didn't happen in the film yet, and I was able to think about, oh, how might these things come out, or how might it go on? Mm. So it was, for me, it was more like a help instead of a spoiler or something like this.
Okay, I mean, yeah. I mean, so at least some moments. I mean, maybe some specific moments it's helpful. Other times, you know, but yeah.
Just a second before we go on, because Uwe Oberg has to leave, and a big applause at this point. It was so great to have you here. That was the next question here, over there. Remberg, kannst du ihm, in diese.
Thank you. I wanted to pick up on what you just said with the that it's, and you mentioned it as well in the other answer you gave about the dominance of the film, of that you kind of subordinated to it because it's so great and you felt drawn to it yourself. I hadn't seen the Oyster Princess myself, so it was the first time seeing it. I was more interested in the dissonance the other spectator just described when there was a difference between the two images which didn't really quite match at the first glance. So this looking up the facts or looking up the history was just an addition which I, to be honest, just gleamed over, and I saw the fact and then I kept watching the film, but I drew out more of the performance when it was a mismatch, when it was a difference between the two, because this is something I wouldn't have maybe combined myself, and because as you just said, when I watch it alone, I can look through this for this information myself, but this for me was sort of an additional support which was so close to what the film was already suggesting that it was very subordinate to the film.
Okay, so yeah, when it's so close, it doesn't really add anything, but when it's so different, then it creates a...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay,
cool. I understand this is a collaboration then. You suggested the film, and then you didn't choose this film. Did you choose the film?
I did choose it, actually.
Because for me, only work with a masterpiece like that. It has to be very well chosen, the film, to be able to work as a, because this is really an amazing performance with the piano and all the thing. And then, like we observe, everybody could see the film. And I, again, will see the film. More of the people will see the film again without that. And this is just rich. What brings new for me is the able to see, because you have all the research thing, in this moment, because it's, for example, this thing with the Beyoncé was scripted. Did you choose exactly this clip before?
Yeah.
Was chosen already. Okay. Because actually, some parts did work out with he drunk and Beyoncé also drunk. And then somehow that would only with the masterpiece would work. Otherwise, I would be not.
Right, not work, yeah.
Yeah, just, I'm unfortunately Annette Brauerhoch left. I was unsure about continuing the commentary. I actually really like the Beyoncé moment, even though I have my issues with Beyoncé.
Okay.
I thought Annette Brauerhoch's comment was right on about the particularly that scene and the way the women move was not the same kind of formation in Lubitsch, it seemed to me. But I thought it was so interesting for me in terms of you reflecting, bringing contemporary references in, but particularly because you had mentioned Busby Berkeley, you showed us Busby Berkeley, and so then I started thinking about different kinds of formations, and particularly formations of women, and the Beyoncé ends with a kind of, I mean, with a Busby Berkeley shot.
But it's meant to be a subversion of the Busby Berkeley.
Exactly, so you get a subversion of Busby Berkeley there, and then you have a very different, we don't have, maybe, I don't know enough, maybe Sonia Campanini knows, but he probably couldn't have done it. I don't know, could he have done an overhead shot, Lubitsch, at that time? But we don't get the overhead shot. I was thinking of the formation, different views of formations of bodies and the different right. effects that that have. Because with Busby Berkeley, it becomes, it culminates in the abstraction of the individual female's bodies into an ornament, which is the image itself. Women can have power becoming a part of an ornament.
Or
that could be a powerful gesture. Right. I don't think that's right. inherently or, disempowering. Or, but I think there's just a lot, the things that, sorry, I'm interrupting you, but I just think that you raised, by juxtaposing them, it provided us with the opportunity to reflect on the aesthetics of formations of bodies.
Yeah.
And which is what Annette Brouwer-Hoch was doing.
And this question, you know, kind of challenging Krakauer, can the ornament be subverted? Can it be appropriated and actually be this progressive, empowering visual? And all of this. And I'd like to think that there's that ambivalence in Lubitsch's staging of this mass ornament of labor happening. Like, it's just fascinating to watch on the one hand, but you do become aware of the excess. And it does become this commentary on just how ridiculous this whole social system is. But at the same time, it also preserves the seductiveness of it as well. So it just seems very ambivalent.
I would be interested in what would you say on what does this mean for the future of cinema if this works so good as it did? What's your opinion? And Rembert, I would like to know what you think.
I mean, it's way too early to know that. All I can tell you is this happened. And so take what you will from it. I mean, I kind of wish I could see it from your point of view. On the other hand, I'm glad I didn't because who knows? I mean, yeah. This was an attempt to bring together a lot of questions and a lot of spaces and experiences that are separated to actually bring them together and see what happens when they have to confront each other and confront it in my own mind as well. And it does kind of resonate in some ways with this what we saw in Lubitsch, where you see all of these people working, and that working somehow combines to create an incredibly visual spectacle. Whereas this feels like a big mess, right? I'm definitely working, but I don't know if I'm creating something beautiful per se, but it's definitely in relation to work and questioning, you know, the aesthetics of cinema compared to social media and this all the side action that we don't consider to be really essential to the cinematic experience and cinematic beauty, but these are all the servants that are in the back of the room, you know, when we think about the cinematic experience, all the research, all the Wikipedia, all the side conversations, these are the servants that you're not supposed to see. And now you're seeing them.
And you could do it interactively. That's what I really like. As you told, we have a question, we are a friend with you on Facebook, we could write you. Can you explain us what just happened? And you you would do it. That's cool.
Yeah. Well, maybe you can implement it in your future program.
Rembert, what would you say?
Yes, I don't think that it affects very much the future of cinema. Cinema does what it always does, so there is not a privileged way of watching films. So films have always been watched in different ways, and we just have to get accustomed to that. A cinema like this is not a church where the lights go out, and it's not a sacred space. And we have to get accustomed to various platforms and devices where films are watched. But I think what is more important for me with this is that I really think that Kevin's desktop criticism is really quite a challenge for film criticism and for the future of film research, and quite different than the video essay. But we still have to talk about that. But it's in a way the challenge is also how to embody the various voices without getting too paternal and too obsessive about materials, and so it increases the complexity of how to write a text about filmic experiences. But this is a long topic, so I think this is way more interesting for me personally in terms of film scholarship and film criticism than with respect to the future of cinema.
Are you a film critic?
I mean, everyone's a critic. I mean, this is, you know, it's just a measure of your abilities to orchestrate and mobilize your mental resources to bring out as much fullness from the film, you know, and whoever does the best job of that is the critic.
Yeah, maybe I just want to add to Rebecca's comment that it doesn't only mean something for the future, but also for the past, because as you mentioned in your presentation, this form of live commenting films was already being performed from the very beginning of cinema. So it's, for me, as a person interested in early cinema, very interesting to see how this form of re-performances or how the performance is still coming back in the cinema experience and in a format which was already there from the very beginning. And also, as you said, for instance, in Japanese cinema.
Just a quick thought also. I thought actually of a home movie viewing when I felt the performance, because sure. You did mention a sort of power relation, and you did have seen the film and you had a script going on. And I think that this whole performance is also very great for teaching film. It did bring not a revolt in me, but I did want to participate too. And sometimes in home family viewing, there's always this case where only, you know, few people gets to comment on the images, which are images of everyone. And I think it's, I don't know, for the teaching of film, I think it's a different way to proceed. I find it interesting.
This one of your plans?
One of my plans?
Yeah.
Get a drink.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, then the discussion is officially closed. Thank you very much for all your contributions.
And thank you very much, Kevin Billy, for this great evening. Thank you. And Rembert Hüser, of course. Und ich möchte Sie darauf hinweisen, die nächste Veranstaltung ist direkt schon nächsten Donnerstag. Merken Sie sich das unbedingt vor. Ute Holl wird hier sein und sie wird Trouble in Paradise präsentieren. Einen der ganz großen amerikanischen Filme von Lubitsch. Es lohnt sich sehr, den anzuschauen. Kommen Sie gut nach Hause und bis bald. Tschüss.